Hello everybody, my name is Andy, this is Miranda, this is George, and this is Zishan. And today for our Global Perspectives presentation, we'll be presenting the countries of Pakistan, Canada, China, and the UK. And the question we have selected today is comparing and contrasting the countries about their cultural differences, as well as its impact on multinational businesses, economic development, and political business practices.
Okay, so the United Kingdom is a sovereign state consisting of the countries of England, Scotland, Wales, and Northern Ireland. It has a population of 66 million people. It's a multinational and multi-faith culture. For example, 87.1% are white, 7% are Asian, and 3% are black. Culturally, the people from the UK are seen as aloof and quite reserved.
How cultural differences influence the cost for multinational businesses?
The UK is a democracy, therefore there is a constant shift in political power. Every 5 years we have an election. These new groups in power are able to establish new laws and legislations that can affect trading with other countries. For
one of these being tariffs.
On import tariffs, there is a 20% VAT in order to protect home-based businesses, making sure that many businesses in our country aren't using cheaper alternatives.
How cultural differences influence the likely future development of our country?
The United Kingdom is no longer part of the European Union, which meant that we had to establish new trade agreements with them. This led to a brief period in which we were unable to trade with a few countries. Furthermore, the newest trade agreements established by Prime Minister Theresa May proposed to the European Union were just rejected this year.
And how cultural differences influence business practices in the UK?
The UK, in terms of work ethic, the UK works 7 days a week, 9 to 5 mostly. If we were to look at countries such as Pakistan, who do not work on Friday, if Tesco decided to open up a store within that country, they would lose out on potentially one day's worth of profit.
So taking a look at Canada, which is also a Commonwealth nation, it is second largest in the world by land mass, and with a population of 36 million people, its official languages are English and French. And its major industries include manufacturing, mining, and real estate. And from a recent study conducted by Statistics Canada in its census, 19% of the total Canadian population identify as a member of a visible minority, out of which 61% identify as South Asian Chinese or Black. And out of the entire population, 1 in 4 Canadians are foreign born. And in a workplace culture context, it is a lone context nation in terms of communication, so verbal and written cues are expected, and being straight to the point and giving clear instructions when making business plans and business agreements. So taking a look at how Canadian business culture affects multinational business and conducting business, because it's such a large country, regional parts of it have influences to conducting business. So the West and the East would have different kind of, a little bit of different influences. And more predominantly in Eastern Canada, in French Canada, also known as Quebec. In the Quebec province, traditionally it has much more protection, much more protectionist and conservative approach to business trade and economic development. And with the recent shift in its recent election of selecting the liberal, much more socialist party in power, it has opened up to a much more liberal view and much more open view in terms of global trade. So with that, it has decreased its foreign investment tax rate for businesses to 26% and meeting up to the national average. And this does open up to Quebec and French Canada as a much more attractive option for French-speaking countries as well as the rest of the world in major hubs such as Montreal. And as an entity, Canada has a stable recognition and a political environment and a strong record for being an economically free, democratic, and socially progressive. And this is from a recent report conducted by Global Affairs Canada. Furthermore, it is part of the North American Free Trade Agreement, also otherwise known as NAFTA, which is a multilateral agreement between the US, Mexico, and Canada, opening up free trade between the three nations. And looking at future development, future economic development for the nation, it is recognized as the best country in the G20 for establishing business operations for the next 5 years up to 2021 by Global Affairs Canada. And furthermore, it is also recognized as a great place to, as one of the most livable countries in the world. And in terms of multilateral agreements, it is finalizing on its final plans with the EU-Canada Comprehensive Economic and Trade Agreement, otherwise known as CETA. And what CETA is, it's established in 2016 and is to remove barriers in trade and tariffs between EU countries and Canada by 98%. And furthermore, it will open up EU companies to bid for public contracts within the nation, as well as opening and offering the opportunity to save up to 590 million euros in foreign direct investment from taxes and such. And it was ratified by Canada in 2017, and we're just waiting for the EU nation states to complete within the next 2 years to ratify the process and finalize the agreement. And taking a look at cultural difference influencing business practice, it is a low-context nation, so once again, verbal cues, it does have played an influence in the working environment. However, being a multicultural country with a high percentage of people being immigrant families, being from a multi-ethnic background, people it does have a blend between high and low-context. Myself, I'm Chinese-Canadian. Working in the workplace, I do have my Chinese side, which is a high context that does blend with low context, so that does need to be considered when working with business professionals in Canada. And furthermore, it is recognized in the G7 as one of the highest concentration of entrepreneurial and educated workforce within the nation, so by Global Affairs Canada.
So as for China, the culture varies widely because of the vast geography and the ethnicity and just mass population size. There are also seven various dialects of the Chinese language, with the most common one being spoken as Mandarin. The ruling party of the nation is the Chinese Communist Party, who are atheists, however slowly more religions are being accepted, such as Taoism and Buddhism. As for the business opportunities, so how it influences the cost of multinational businesses doing business with China, child labour is still a very important issue in China, and there could be a lot of ethical and legal reason costs or into the business engaging in those activities. Another important thing they have is called a CHOP system. So it's a red stamp that acts as like a signature. And it's legally binding and it has to be registered with the Public Security Bureau. The approximate cost is about $500 plus the cost of making the stamp, which is relatively inexpensive. So UK businesses or any other businesses engaging with China need to monitor that carefully, because if you own the stamp, so you can do anything. As for trade unions, activities are quite limited, and all activity must be carried out under knowledge of the All China Federation of Trade Unions. For the likely economic development of China, our corporation tax was actually cut to 15% back in January 2017, and this would benefit both China and businesses engaging in operations with them greatly. China because of the foreign direct investment, and also the employment opportunities and sort of injections into the country. And also the businesses doing with it because they would benefit from lower corporation tax. As for growth, the World Bank actually increased their 2017 forecast due to an increase in personal consumption and also foreign trade. However, they have kept their 2018 and 2019 percentage of growth at 6.4% and 6.3% respectively due to a less accommodative monetary policy and also the government's effort to rein in credit and control leverage. They did actually move from a plan to a market economy back in 1987 when Deng Xiaoping came to power, and actually it's seen an average of 10% GDP increase year on year up until 2010. As for FDI, that has increased year on year due to social, political and economic stability, and the anti-corruption campaign that was started in 2013 has actually helped to stabilise interest rates. As for cultural differences influencing the business practice, there is a high emphasis on relationships. So you may have to meet several times before a decision is actually come to. Punctuality and body language is also very key. You should remain calm and collected, and it's always be very formal and polite, just to show respect to who you're talking to. As for conversing and topics of conversation, just learning a few words in Chinese is always greatly appreciated. And topic of conversation that often come up would be art, scenery, and geography, whereas you should avoid talking about things such as politics, human rights, and animal treatment.
Pakistan is a country which is was created so the Muslims could live a day-to-day life based on the religion of Islam. households are led by males. They bring the financial income, while the women are required to just not required, but due to culture, they have to run the household, look after the kids, and just be more as housewives in Pakistan. Moving on, multinational corporations in Pakistan, the cultural differences will play a major part. Now this is because of the duties Islam brings to the population of Pakistan. Now the daily prayers would interrupt business on a Friday as businesses are closed. Due to the weak infrastructure, multinational corporations would have to accept the major power shortages that they are in Pakistan, with power cutting up to 4 times a day. Now, with the future growth in Pakistan is the sixth most populous country in the world, with 50% of the population being under the age of 25. You have 600 foreign companies in Pakistan. Business trends in Pakistan would again, religion would have to play a part, because Pakistani Muslims are required to pray up to 5 times a day. This would have interrupt their work schedule, but because it is obligatory to do, multinational corporations would have to accept this.
So taking a look at a synthesis between the four nations that we presented for you today, we'll be taking a look at different aspects that make up between the four countries. So looking at communication methods between Canada, United Kingdom, and Pakistan, they're all considered and recognized as low context nations, all of which they were Commonwealth countries, followed by which doesn't have an influence on that, followed by China with the much more traditional high context culture, so nonverbal cues there. Following a look at the economic views, Canada itself is a much more socialist country. China as well has a much more open a socialist view as well, because of its political totalitarian rule, a one-party system. It's considered a communist economic view. And United Kingdom and Pakistan both fall under the conservative category. And looking at bilateral and multilateral free trade agreements, so between two or more countries in terms of free trade, Canada has currently 16 in place, China has 14, UK has 15, and Pakistan has 12.
As for culture and faith, both Canada and the United Kingdom, multicultural, multi-faith, whereas China, they are still predominantly atheist, however slowly more religions being accepted, such as Taoism and Buddhism, whereas Pakistan is still very much a Muslim country. When it comes to healthcare, both the United Kingdom and Canada, free universal healthcare, whereas in China and Pakistan, they have both public and private, but predominantly have to pay for it. And as for the working week, for all the countries, it's averaged about 45 hours a week, with Canada being sort of the lowest working hour at 40 weeks,